you, Brother Paul. That makes me feel real good to know that I'm welcome back after almost 3 weeks of staying with you. It goes to show that we have a mutual fellowship. It doesn't, even death doesn't separate us from each other. We live on somewhere. Love moves on. After all things are gone, love still stands. For their promises, they shall fail. For their tongues, they shall cease. But under love and good works, still on, on, live on. Happy to be here, as I say again this afternoon. I had this opportunity to talk to you just a little while. Rather warm. And tonight, this is healing service. Closing of the revival. And we're going to try tonight, if possible, to minister to every one that we possibly can. We've cut most of the time in or praying for the sick. Now, I got home just very late the next day. That was on Saturday, on Friday night, and then Saturday morning I had a service. Saturday afternoon, late, I had several emergencies that had to be taken care of right at once, and then I left for a church last night. Got in just a little while ago, about an hour. I had service this afternoon and tonight. Tomorrow at noon I have service to do all the day. So, see where it goes, it's just constantly on the move. But we're very happy to be anywhere that we can speak just a little word for Jesus. I'm so thankful for the ministers here and the thing that to kind of inspire or help them along. That's the purpose of being here, trying to help others. I could never take the message to all the world myself. It's going to take thousands of us together to do this. And together, when we can unite ourselves, forgetting about our churches and our doctrines and so forth, to just know this one thing, Christ and be crucified. And know that among us. And I think that God will speak to us to do a marvelous work right away. I believe we're going to see the moving of the Spirit like we have never in all the ages. I feel led to say this, which I felt for some time in the last few weeks. I believe that a little potion that God has given to me to try to minister to the others, God is going to set it up again into something else that will be more marvelous than one the other signs God has given to do before the people. I believe it will be more gracious than ever been yet. Pray for me. And if others detect the inspiration and just move up close to God like a great Christian army go marching on. I want to say again from the little present and things that have given me this week. I didn't get to open some of them until they got home. It's all appreciated. Even the little girl and I, when we got home, when someone gave me a box of cookies, and he said, I need to cook cookies. He said it, a little girl and I. I'm very happy to have them. Now, that we do not wish to take too much of time. How many people are in the building here today that are Christians? Let's see, are Christians all over the place? Oh my. Is there any sinners? Let's see if anybody's a sinner. Put up their hand. You mean that you're not a sinner?
Thank you. Just with a little factor about the 10 to make a public confession of it. pray that you'll speak to that heart today. Pray them to the all of repentance. They might find thee near to their heart. Those who without the Holy Spirit, may they come today. May, O God, search me and try me, if there be any evil in me, and wash me by thy blood, that I might receive thee, the Holy Spirit, into my heart. Forgive us of our shortcomings, for we, thy children, have erred. Many a times we err from the way, and we pray that you forgive us. Bless the word I do not know, you know, Father, that I do not know one word that I shall say to that church. Just announcing perhaps on the return of the prodigal son to speak to him. Just go to wait on you. What you say, we'll say. Bless all the words that go forth, may they fall in fertile ground, for it's worth a hundredfold, for we ask them in the name of the Master of Christ. Amen. I do not know why I said that subject to speak on the return of the prodigal son. I haven't read this scripture for the past 8 years, but I know it. Haven't read this. On it, I guess it's been 8 or 10 years ago since I spoke on it. And I think when I did that, I approached it from the way of the Pharisee, the son that was left at home, that felt bad towards his brother. And I believe that's the way the story goes. And he was very provoked because the father had received the lost, straying son back. His attitude of approach to it. And I spoke to the church about how that they should not feel that way, that when a sinner comes to the altar, the whole church are together right around them. Don't you believe that? Not long ago, down near Burstville, Kentucky, where I was born, it was on Memorial Day. I've been about 5 years ago. I was speaking there on Sunday afternoon, and I was just thinking a few moments ago, what a difference. Here we are, cars parked around, a lovely auditorium. And down there was a little old church made of clapboard shingles, split logs, way back up. And when they'd taken me up that day, there was horses all along. Speaking of the morning had him singing. I was standing there on the platform, and he had the Amen corner on one side and the ladies over on the other side. And they were didn't have no song book at all. They had an old organ that you pumped with a stick. Did you ever see one? Let's see if anybody ever seen an organ. Oh yeah, that you pumped with a great big pole that got out of the woods, they pumped this organ. And sometimes they wouldn't use it because some of the keys were out. They had an old tuning fork. They'd get to that part, the minister would they'd all catch it and start singing. He was singing, "We'll fear no evil when we come to die, for Jesus will take us in his arms and carry us safely home." Those people, how that they respected God. I spoke to him about divine healing that afternoon. Or that night, rather. And the next day I was squirrel hunting up on the side of the hill. I heard the saws going down the holler, and I thought I'd go down to see what they were doing. 4 or 5 men were standing down there with their rifles sitting against a tree while the fuse goes on. And they were sawing wood, and one of them speaking said, "I believe that preacher told the truth." And one of them said, "That was a blankety blankety, mister. That's the only way you had to express yourself, I guess." And there was, I walked up where they were at, they were talking. And one of them had a great big chew of tobacco. Almost looked like that big sticking out the side of his mouth. Jaw puffed out. He was just the head speaker. When I walked up, I said, "Hello." And they turned around. This big fella looked at me, swallowed that chew tobacco, took off his hat and said, "Good morning, Parson Branham." I thought, wow, that was enough to kill him almost. A great big wad of tobacco like that. But while speaking in the afternoon, dinner had been served. Of course, I believe the people up here, that would have been lunch. But it's dinner. I eat three meals a day, breakfast, dinner, and supper down at the south. So I got mixed up when they were going to say dinner time up here. Supper time, I missed out supper. So anyhow, the horses were chomping down in the woods. And I was speaking on the subject of the resurrection of Christ. And when a big old boy sitting back there, the place was crowded full, and he ran to the altar, hollered, "God have mercy on my soul." And when he came up, well, he never got halfway to the altar, or God had saved me. Well, there's about 50 of those old mammies out there. Grabbed him around the neck and down the altar and went with him. There's about 50-some-odd conversions that afternoon. And now they didn't get down there and just make a dry-eyed confession and get up. They prayed through about 2 hours of it. They got up their clothes and wet, you could just wring them out before they perspired. They got up shouting and down through the woods and up over the hills. They went hard, "Hallelujah, hallelujah." Listen, folks. They might have been Baptists, but they had real old-time Holy Ghost religion. That's right. Because they lived that way. By your fruits, you're known. That's true. Now, while I read you pray, if you will, over in 15th chapter of St. Luke, we wish to read these verses of the Scripture beginning with the 11th verse of the 15th chapter of St. Luke. And he said, "A certain man had 2 sons. The younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me.' And he divided unto them his living. Not many days after, the younger gathered all together and took his journey to a far country, and there wasted his substance throughout his living. And we had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country. And he sent him to his field to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, 'How many hard servants my father has, bread enough to spare, and I perish. I will arise and go to my father and say unto him, Father, I sinned against heaven and before thee, and I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me one of thy hired servants.' And he rose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran, fell on his neck and kissed him. His son said unto him, Father, sinned against heaven and denied God. And no more words to be called by the Son. But the Father said to his servant, bring forth the best clothes, put a ring on his hand, shoes on his feet. Bring into the fatted calf and kill it. Let us eat, be merry, for this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and was found. And they began to make merry." The Lord had his blessings to the Word. As a minister, as a speaker, I am not. My part, this life here on earth, is to pray for sick people, which I greatly and love to do. And I'm not educated. The only thing that I can say is when I read the Scripture, look for every word. Just as he said, then I And you pray with me, all of these minister brothers, while I try to speak on this subject for just a few moments. The one thing noticeable, Jesus speaking this parable, he was trying to express the feeling of the Father to the lost, to those who were alienated from God, gone out. Remember, one time we were all alienated, cut off from God, without mercy, without hope, walking about in the world of darkness, lost forever. Jesus taken our place as a sinner and died in our stead. And the Father received him gladly, such as will come to him. How hard is God? I've often wondered, what would life be? What could I ever expect if it had not been for Jesus? Or where would I be? What would be my fate? I laid in the hospital not long ago, met a medical doctor, a patient, and looked into my face after anesthetic, some mistakes in my heart. Shocked the spine anesthetic a little above what it should have been. My heart was beating 17 times. The doctor told my father when he was ready to say, what is my time? Did you ever get out of bed? 3 minutes to live. All my sins just before. And the things that I did not have sin, the things before me as many times to the Christians here, we try to justify ourselves and say, well, this isn't very bad, but believe sin to be confessed all of it. No matter how little it looks to you, it's sin in the sight of God. Look how little the person is, but look what it did to the human race. The first sin was committed, look at the difference. When the message came to heaven that your son has fallen, well, look like Adam ought to have been running around through the garden, calling, oh Father, where are you? But Adam went and hid himself. And it was just vice versa. It was the Father calling, Son, where art thou? See how a man will try to justify himself? He'll try to stand behind something. Instead of coming right out and saying what he is and confessing his sins before God, he'll try to hide behind something. And here was the searchings of God. Walking, running, up and down the garden, screaming for his lost boy. The Father hunting, searching for the Son. It should have been the Son searching for the Father. And today, it's just the same. Just as soon as man sins, and instead of coming out and confessing his sin before God, you'll try to get back. He'll try to hide behind something. He'll try to get a self-made religion. Look at Adam. They made papers of fig leaves. Cut that around. The fig leaves. But when they came to the place where God called Adam and Eve to stand before him, they realized that they had a man-made religion. The word religion means a covering. And they were covered by a self-made apron. You see it? Now, that strain is in man yet today. And instead of trying to come God's way of repentance and believing on his Son, letting the blood of his Son cleanse us from our sins, we slip around.
try to find some other way, some way of escape from coming God's way. We'll say, well, this religion, we'll join this, or we'll do this where it's not quite so strict. And the fig made leaves, when they had to face God, was no good. And you'll find out, my dear friend, that man-made theories will not stand when you're coming down to the last breath of this body, this life. It's good to live for those things, but you can't die by it. Now, I guess for my age of the ministry, I've probably stood by as many dying people as anyone of my age, because I've been much called on to the dying. Not long ago, a certain young lady in our city had received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. She came up to the tabernacle. Another young lady in the city, very popular, belonged to a modern type of religious group that denied the blood and the covering and said that we were a puff and a bunch of holy rollers because that we believed in the saving grace of Christ. If that's what it takes to be a holy roller, then I am one, for I believe in the blood. This young lady went to dance shows, but she was the Sunday school teacher in the church. The church denied the blood of Christ. Said there was no such a thing. The pastor said it dried up 1900 years ago. The social gospel. And by, the young lady got out with some boys. Fine-looking little lady. This little girl came up the tabernacle. She kind of dressed kind of old-fashioned. She used to go down the street in her hair pulled back as tight as she could get it without the, ever what you call the manicure on her face, ever what the stuff is that they wear. On down the street she would go. Yes, it's the truth. We teach against it. God help preachers to get out to the gospel. Listen, ladies. There was only one woman in the Bible that ever painted herself to meet a man, and that was Jezebel, and God fed her to the dogs. So when you say, well, that's how do this dog meet, that's exactly what it was. God fed her to the dogs. You don't want to be like her. God will make you pretty in your way. Pretty isn't pretty to us. But even our holiness churches are letting down. You know that's the truth. You better come back to the old hewing line again. Back to the gospel. Now, notice this young lady, she just carried on everywhere. Went out to dances and parties and so forth. She taken sick. She didn't understand what was the matter, but when the doctor got to her, she had a venereal disease. She could be far from her. Tried some shots, but it didn't work. So the pastor told her she'd go right on to heaven because she was a Sunday school teacher. So they all gather in the room, the seers go out, the angels of the Lord come together. Just passed from the street a little while before that. The pastor was standing out in the hall of the home, lovely big home, fine people. Just stepped out of the room, Sunday school class is all in, singing songs, the seer go to heaven, and the pastor stepped out to smoke, out in the hall, and when death struck the girl, she began to get history, and she said, where is that girl? And they said, what girl? They said, here's all your class. She said, I'm not talking about them, I'm talking about that girl that called her name, that from up there at the tabernacle that used to speak to me about my soul. They said, go get her. They went to the pastor and he
came running in. He said, "Now, honey, listen." He said, "We'll call the doctor and give you a shot. You're getting a little hysterical." She said, "I'm not hysterical." She said, "You deceiver of man. I'm lost and going to hell because you taught me that." And the girl died and went out to meet God lost, crying for the girl that had tried to tell her what was right. Look, brother, when you come down to the end of this life's journey, you'll wish you had lived a holy, clean life before God. Be sure to remember that. Now about your church, what you belong to, that doesn't mean nothing. What you are in your heart. God ain't going to ask you whether what church you belong to, what you are in your heart, is what God's going to say. Notice how the Jesus speaking here about the Father and the Son going away. He must have been had this on his mind of how that God searching, calling, pulling the people to repentance. And today the Holy Spirit still going through the land, calling out to the lost and the dying. Before we leave this here about the fig leaves, I wish to say one more word. Notice what God did. God, when he met with Adam and them, they had their own made religion. As in 24 hours ago, someone said, "Brother Branham, you know what my religion is?" He said, "My religion is the golden rule. You're the richest man of this world." I said, "That's good, but that hasn't got any salvation." Right. "Except the man be born again, he will in no wise enter the kingdom." Born of the Spirit of God. Renewed, regenerated, become a new person in Christ Jesus. Old things passed away and all things become new. Converted, changed over. Going to rope this way, turn, come this way. Life the virtue. Now, but then, when they stood before God, Adam was afraid to come out. He said, "I'm naked." Now notice, God went out and got some skin and come in and made aprons and tied them around. Now notice, if God got skin, he had to kill something. Something has to die to make a cover. And he killed something and got the skin off of it. And something died in their place because the penalty was dead. So an innocent victim had to die for the guilty to cover them up. And so is it today, friends. Not the golden rule, which is all right. Not the Ten Commandments, which is holy. But God killed something to cover you up. His Son, Christ Jesus, died on Calvary, the innocent for the guilty, to make a way that you and I might be innocent in him before God. That's the thing that the Holy Spirit is searching through the land today to try to find someone to believe on him. On Christ Jesus. Now, our story starts a very pathetic story to me. As I shall try to approach the dust a little bit now, listen closely. Let's set a drama this afternoon. Picture back just a little bit so that the children might receive God help our children. Not long ago, the great G. Edgar Hoover outfit, Captain Al Farrar, great man, overall the juvenile of the Hoover outfit, came to my meeting, murdered, led to Christ. I stood in his office, what it was, out in Fresno, California, and had a meeting 3 nights, we went there to Seattle. Introduced me and just as he did, someone stepped up with plain clothes on, tucked his shoulder,
I'd like to have a word to say. Dr. Bobbers, that's not customary here, sir. Short as traditional, he was tapping out the rod. And he said, yes, sir. He said, friend, 10,000. And yes. And he said, Captain, I'm Captain Al Farrar. He said, most everyone here knows me because my native home is here in Washington, home. He said, my business is to break up rackets. And he said, when I heard this brand of the pair of friends of the city, I went to Fresno to stop the racket. That I've seen those things, I heard the preacher speak, and he didn't seem like a racketeer to me. That we brought, went and got a medical doctor and sent a little boy in there that was been paralyzed, and his limbs from polio. Polio had just seen him. And said when he came to, stayed the night, finally they got the boy in the line. Said when he came to, Brother Branham said he's a victim of polio. And he asked the father if he would believe. And so the father was on the police force. And said he would believe. Said Brother Branham said within the space of 8 days, the boy shall be well. And said we've watched him. And said the little lad standing behind the curtain here tonight, perfectly normal. He turned back to school. He said, I want you all to be well and rest assured of this. We check their findings, what they do with it. And the thing that I want you to know that it's not a racket, that is true as the hand of Almighty God. The next day, he take me down to this big jail where they had there, and we had the young ladies in there, some of them gun fighters. They were walking up and down the floor, cursing one another. He said, what do you think of that, Reverend Branham? I said, oh, I said, can I speak a word to him? He said, certainly. I went down to the young man there, and there they were in there in a horrible condition. He showed me how with his desk, he pressed a button to open the person's mouth. He could only leave from here. Someone would shoot him. He touched the button here, and it locked every police and everything all around the place. Then after he was finished, he had two guards with him. And when we went down into the gallery, he said, you like guns, don't you, Brother Branham? I said, yes. We went down into the gallery, beneath, way down, the cell light. He said, here's where we practice with the young man. He began to tell how far you could be from one place to the other, and how to shoot, so forth. I noticed he kept looking down at me, and I wondered what he was going to do. This the officer said to him, and we were in this little place alone, metal all around. He said, Brother Branham? Yes, sir. What do you think over on my shoulder? He said, wonder if there's a chance. I said, what do you mean, Captain? He said, I can't be a bad man. He said, I'm not a member of the law. You are not a member. He said, but I really want to find Jesus.
now there's an old-fashioned country home. Let's just fix it in our minds for a moment. I can see living there a lovely old couple. Work hard all their life and have a little son. Of course, the son always falls heir with his inheritance. And then this younger son, perhaps, let's see, they went to church every Sunday. And they love God, and they serve God with all their heart. But one day, this younger son, say he would start going out with a group that he had no business going to. Listen to me.
Thank you.
know, I can see now he's going to ask his daddy, and his dad's getting old, mother getting old. When he comes in one day and gets tired, gets a sass at his mother and his father, first thing he said, "Father, I want you to give me my potion. I'm tired of playing around the house here and doing these things. All I see on Sunday is go to church and rest the morning and that way. They're all out going to have their own way. I want to do as the rest of them have. Don't you never follow the crowd. You follow me." Well, that's the attitude of young people, isn't it? I want to be like the rest of them. Don't tell me you're patterned yourself by them. Pattern them. You're patterned by me. Then I hear the people used to. I hear the father say, "Well, son, this is the only way I have to live. This is the only livelihood. Well, I have an inheritance. You give it to me. My right. What is your right?" I can see the poor father is bothering him very much. "Well, what are you going to do, son?" He said, "I'm going down to the city and live like the vocation. Stay with mother and I. We love you with all of our hearts. We want to be good to you. We've done everything we can." But that wasn't satisfied. Satan has got a hold on him. So he was going down to the city to live like the rest of the worldly people. Then I see his father tell mother, say, "Mother, you know what happened? Our boy has got the wrong crowd. He's a young man now, so he's asked to sell the farm, take all that I have, divide it among you and his brother. I'll be talking. I'm to the old mother. God bless her, dear old mother. Had one of them. How I love her. I look at my eye up here. She is truly and I like to believe the mother has got a very long time. I so enjoy the look of you and see her and her feet. I said, "Mother, I must know what I'd like to see from God." This old mother, I can think of her and her story and say, "You see her go through her son and say, 'Son, mother will wash the door behind her. Guide you everything she could. Or yet, now I'm going to say, Mama, you get on the way with that stuff. That's old time. I don't want something like that. I'm going to have my way. I'm really of age now, so I'm going to have my way about it." I see her put her arms down in the buggy. She was hugging. Without natural affection, that's the way it is today. The child rules the home now and says, "Father, they're the ones who build the boss." Shame. Without natural affection, I see the mother talking, look at the folks. One of these days, that old dad that you'd be ashamed of, just because he goes to church, maybe gets happy and shouts, "Wow, that boyfriend, that girlfriend of yours in church, that, oh, look, you get that awful, and you're just a little bit ashamed of it." There'll be a time when you won't be ashamed of it. Not long ago, a young lady come in from college, her mother washed her before the dinner at the house. When she drove in to the station, she had to brought a young girl with her. She got away from Bob, away from the church. And the young girl was with her. And the young girl sitting in the train looking out. And there stood her mother on the outside. She was all scarred up. And the young girl was with the other coming from college said, "Look at that old haggy looking woman." That isn't she horrible?
sister. And the girl was so devoted. She got away. Got away from the church of God. She's so provoked. She turned her back and looked that way. She said, my darling, what happened to you? And she was so embarrassed because of her girlfriend. Just then, one of the conductors who knows the story walked up and grabbed that young girl by the shoulders and looked in the air and said, what do you mean? That you ashamed of your mother since you've been away to college? That remember, you know the story. That one day the house is burning down. Your mother was a beautiful woman, far more beautiful than you are, or ever will be. And said you were a little crying baby when she was hanging the clothes in the backyard. And all at once the house caught fire. And here come the fire engines to put it out. And the house is aflame. And you were crying up in the upstairs. No one would dare to pierce the flame. That little mother wrapped herself, and in there she ran through the flame. She grabbed you and took her clothes from her body, wrapped your face up, wrapped you all up, and put your arms and placed her own face to the flames, and through the flames she comes and rescued you. But that's why you're pretty today, and that's why she's scarred. Are you ashamed of scars? That's the way Jesus did for us when we were sinners, ugly before God. Cast away, turned away. He came, the lovely Son of God, from the ivory palace, and come down upon the earth and took the shame upon himself and the sin upon himself and died there at Calvary crying, should I be ashamed of his gospel? Christians on the streets, we're ashamed to stand up for the gospel. When he was marred and made ugly that you could be free, he was marred for sin and you could be free from sin. Don't never deny it. Always loving, stand for that which is true, stand for his gospel. And now, that's the way of the attitude nearly of young people today. This young son is feeling the same way. He said, mother, I don't want no more to do with this family. All you do is go to church. All I hear, watch. I can see the old father put a sale sign up now. You're kind of dramatizing this, of course, for the benefit of the young people. Then I can see put a sale sign up to sell the old farm, get all the goods together, and divide it up among the boys. Mother and dad will just live as long as their potion lasts, maybe, and then it'll be over. Notice, I can see when they divided the potion to the young boy. Got his money in his pocket. He said, now I'll have a good time. The next morning, I see him go and say to his mother, old lady, pack my clothes now. I'm going to leave in the morning. Oh, my. How that poor old mother would go and get the little things that he wore when he was a little boy. Tuck them away. Look at them. I see her pick up a little pair of shoes. You know, mothers like to keep things like that. Mama's got my old shoes. I wore them out. Got the long dress like she had the baby. It's a treasure to a mother's heart. I can see this old mother take these little shoes and set them up on the organ. Get down there and pray and say, oh, God, take care of my boy. Leaving me now. How many of you have ever had an old-fashioned mother like that? Let's see your hand. Oh, aren't they lovely and sweet? Take care of my boy. He's gone out with the world, and I don't know what will happen to him. Only take care of him, Father. Pray. Did you ever have your mother pray for you? Oh, my little old mother, I've seen her go back in her room to herself when we would be without food and kneel down on her knees and cry out to God. God, give us some more old-fashioned praying mothers like that. That's the backbone of our nation. That's right. Good God saves mothers. I can see her crying out to God, God, take care of my boy. No matter what you ever do, she's here. Her heart's always ready to forgive and come back. Then I can see the old daddy just weary, walking back and forth, up and down on the outside.
God save people, they worry about their children. I'm a father myself, and I've got little boys, and you're looking at me right now. God knows. I just want those heads to die this afternoon. Let me die 10,000 times. That's right. That is saved. It's the love that we have for our offspring. That's the reason God so loved the Lord, his offspring. That he came himself and died that we might be free. Pay the penalty himself. I notice this father weary walking back and forth up and down. The next day, when it comes time for the boy to leave, I came packing his little suitcase and get out there. I see, before I say, so long, folks, and start off. Mother said, just a moment. Before you go, let's have prayer one more time. Kneel down on the floor and see the old mother and dad with their arms around one another. Pray to God. God, we praise thee because of this Lord. He's gone out from away from us now, wandering. Please, Father, take care of him. I'm going to say, oh, this restless father praying. They didn't want to hear them prayers of mother and dad. No more. He had other things on his mind. That's the reason sometimes we're impatient. Just can't wait a few minutes. Can't pray. Can't wait for a prayer. But there will come a time, friend, when you'll have all eternity to think about. Pray now. Be ready now to meet the man. I can hear him pray and get up. Mother try to hug him, and he turned his head. His dad put his arms around him and cried. He said, oh, you all want off to start off. Went over the hill. I can see father and mother stand there with their hands, arms around one another, waving goodbye to him as he went off over the hill, down into the city to be with the rest of the world. And this parent, I see them return back into the house again, weeping, crying, praying. I see him give to the big crowd down there, and as long as his money lasted, he was a good fellow. That's the way the world treats you. As long as you got money, you got friends. But when your money's gone, your friends are gone. That's dry weather friends. I know a friend who will stick by you if you haven't got a penny. Jesus Christ, Son of God. I've been to a place where I had not a cent. He loved me. He loved me just as much if I was to have a cent as if we had $1 million. He loves you just the same. That's pure, holy, adultery love. Comes from God alone down into his people. That's the way we should love one another, with that godly love. Notice. And I can see him in the great, in the places of gambling devices and halls of ill fame and so forth. And after a while, his money was gone and his friends was gone. He was a popular boy. He could have a date with any of the girls. But when his money was gone, they were gone with the crowd. That's just the way the devil is. As long as you got money and popular, all right. But when that time wears out, you're finished. That's all before the world. And I could see he had to get himself a job. So he went to a citizen of the country, a hog raiser. Look where he dropped from now. A Jew. Not even supposed to put their hands on the carcass of a hog. And he was in need. He was starving. And he had to take a job. And to give him the worst thing, that's the way the devil does. Just as soon as he can get you started down the hill, he'll trap you with everything he's got. I see.
He was a good man. He was a good fellow then. They joined himself with a citizen of the country, and the citizen gave him two big slop buckets to go slop the hog. Think of a blaze of Jewish boys out there slopping hogs in the pig feed, away from mother, away from religion that he once had to keep away from hogs.
Now he was rooting it. That's the way the devil would do. He'll get you to smoke your first cigarette, tell you there's no harm in it. After a while, you're a cigarette fiend. He'll tell you there's no harm in taking a sociable drink. sing, oh, God, take him, boy. Wherever he is, what a state he can take care of his father and send him home. Work it down in the hall. Down in the hall. The angel of God. Boy, wake up. Paul takes it all. Heirs of the kingdom. Rich.
Thank you.
not sure about your experience. Come now, will you? What we say? That bright day may be tomorrow. That bright day may be tomorrow. That bright day may be tomorrow. All the others go. Oh, won't that be a happy meeting? Won't that be a happy meeting? Won't that be a happy meeting? All the others go. I remember when my brother was dying. Yeah.
to take him away. He's still praying for those at the altar. There's 300 or 400 people at the altar seeking the face of the Lord. And yeah, they've just brought a whole great big armload of handkerchiefs that are all in an individual stamped and self-addressed envelopes. And he's going to be praying over the envelopes now. He's praying individually for a few as Brother Howard Branham moves him away from the altar. He's preached until he's just about preached himself out. They're actually taking him away. Oh, praise the Lord. This is simply wonderful. One of the greatest altar services we've ever seen. Well, he's stopping on the way out here and there to talk to different ones or to shake hands with them and pray for them. Well, bless the Lord. There he goes now. Right,